Timescale's flexibility, it being built on a relational model at the end of the day, and its ability to, you know, do the partitioning under the covers and the hypertables to let us access, you know, all of the data back in time very quickly is the magic combination that we were looking for in a time series database to meet our use case.
Density is a space monitoring and people counting company. Our customers are generally the Fortune 2000, customers who have very large real estate footprints. Especially now after COVID, people want to know how their space is being used.
And I'll tack on there that density provides that value while maintaining anonymity of all of the, you know, people that walk underneath our sensors. And that's not a thing that other solutions are able to provide. In Timescale, we store counts of people in spaces over time, and a wealth of derivative metrics off of those people counts. We call it dwell time, like how long was this space used contiguously, or you know, what was its usage compared to similar space types throughout the day or in other parts of my portfolio.
So if you can imagine, companies are making $1 million, sometimes $1 billion of decisions without any data. There's no other industry where that would happen. You always make decisions based on data. Density actually provides data where it used to not be possible to provide that data. So we've done a couple different things. The very first thing we did was implement our own time scale in a much less elegant way, with none of the benefits and much more complexity. And then we probably overcorrected and pushed too much into a pre-counting pipeline where we would do all the counts and then just store that count data into vanilla Postgres. And I think we found the happy medium now where we do a little bit of transformation to get the data exactly how we need it so that Timescale can do very efficient and very useful aggregations for us. And we can quickly iterate on those aggregations. So we find the right primitives. We transform the data into the correct primitives, put those into Timescale, and allow Timescale to do aggregations.
Top factors, if I had to just name a few, that led us to Timescale specifically were its tolerance for high insert rates. And so far, it's just blown all of our expectations out of the water, even based on benchmarks that we were able to see online at the time. There's very little in the way of a special Timescale, you know, DSL, domain-specific language, and it's operationally very familiar to operating vanilla Postgres. Both of those were huge wins, just both operationally and development-wise. Like, we always have the ability to fall back on core Postgres principles or relational data models as we need to for whatever ends we're trying to achieve with Timescale. But we also have the capability to dive deeper into Timescale specific functionality to, you know, meet those big time series use cases. Yeah, it's hard to name my most favorite Timescale feature, but continuous aggregates in and of themselves have been a big game changer in a variety of different ways. Early on, whenever we first onboarded to Timescale and deployed, it made development significantly faster in that we could just offload a lot of decision logic and complexity around like time zone handling and bucketing. You know, that's a big one, to Timescale, and you know, let it handle that complexity for us. But and continuous aggregates come and play into that, in that we were able to roll up multiple resolutions of our, you know, sensor count data, our people count data, and make that available in a much more efficient way with, you know, little to no effort so far as the code that we actually had to write to deliver those efficiencies.
I will just say, tacking on to Brock's answer, I can't tell you how many little issues that just went away when we started using Timescale and bucketing and just relying on standard Postgres timestamp and date time handling, as opposed to doing that at the application layer. It was really nice to be able to do that close to the data.
Yeah, the keystone example is probably daylight savings time, but, you know, twice a year you get two extra hours in a bucket, you know, if you're rolling up to an hour, and that can cause all sorts of weird problems. And we had quite a few of those problems until we kind of standardized on the pushing that logic down into Timescale.
Yeah, it's no fun having to explain to your customer success team or customers themselves why after daylight savings time your graph went backwards and then it went forward again. My advice, at least for an IoT company, is consider your real-time use cases and your historical use cases and consider them separately. What we found out is we treated everything the same. Everything went through the same pipeline and it was just queries that were different. When you're using Timescale and really any architecture, it's extremely useful to consider those use cases different or separately. And then architect them separately. They have different requirements. If you try to shoehorn everything in and put any time series database, whether it's something awesome like Timescale or something else, it's gonna cause problems and it's not gonna scale very well. You can do a lot more by separating out historical and real-time use cases.
What would you use if Timescale didn't exist is one of those topics that I like to not think about because it gives me anxiety. There's plenty of other time series database options out there. I'm sure all of us could name at least 10 of them, but none of them fit the cross-section of requirements that at least density has in quite the manner that Timescale does. So whenever somebody else asks me that question, like in passing, I'm just like, well, let's just pretend like that's not possible and go about our business.